chapter 2, verse 24 and 25. Go all the way back to the beginning to bring this thing to a close. If you haven't been traveling with us, you're in here for the first or second time, we've been walking through Operation Transformation as a Bible study, and which will eventually move into our transformation groups. And so what we want to do is, if you get a chance to go back on the app, you can listen to them and catch up and kind of see all that's been going on. And so please tune into the app and catch up and get with us. Amen. Genesis 2, verse 24 and 25. Genesis chapter 2, verse 24 and 25. And the Bible reads, "For this reason, a man shall leave his father and his mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed." You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Heavenly Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be holy and acceptable in your sight, for you are my rock and my redeemer. Father, Lord, speak to us tonight, Lord, as we gather together as brothers and sisters in the body of Christ. Lord, and help us to dive deeply into the Word of God so that you might reveal and expose truth to us in such a way that our lives are changed. That we're not just hearers of your word, but we're doers of your word, God, that we recognize, Lord, what you have desired and designed. And Lord, we don't stay stuck in where we are, but we move, God, to what you designed for us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And thank God. Tonight's message, it's marital. We're going to deal with how deep is your love? How deep is your love? Amen. Some of y'all remember that song. How deep is your love? Now, Genesis 2, verse 24. We're going to really tonight concentrate in an area to deal with what does it look like inside, if you're a married individual, what does it look like to be in a marriage that's naked and unashamed? And then secondly, if you're unmarried and possibly looking at getting married, what does it look like for me to prepare to be in a relationship that's naked and unashamed? Because if you're unmarried, you've yet to experience what it is that you're going to face inside a marriage. And so as we walk through it tonight, I think that you'll flow with me. But I need you to recognize from a single perspective, preparing yourself to be in a relationship to where you're exposed daily, every single day, to a person. And what does it mean to be naked and unashamed with that individual? And then for married couples, oftentimes what we're going to find out tonight is that we are inside of a marriage and we're not naked and unashamed. You know, we're not living as God designed, but we're actually trying to cover ourselves up. And so we want to deal with this tonight in Genesis 2, verse 24 and 25, and just a few other passages on the night. So let me deal with the very first thing. God designed our marital unions to begin with a separation from the old and a connection and creation of the new. God designed our marital unions to begin with a separation from the old and a connection and a creation of the new. Notice what he says in Genesis 2, verse 24. As he talks about Adam having received his wife. "For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh." So you're going to have a leaving from one situation and a cleaving to a new situation. Although a man and a woman have been raised inside what you would call your nuclear family, you've been raised inside of the unit with your father or mother or whoever else was in your main home, he says that when you make a decision to marry somebody else, you have to leave father and mother, your old situation that you're familiar with, and create a new situation that you're unfamiliar with. And what he's saying is that you can't depend on the past from what you got from mom and dad to carry that into a new relationship alone. that there may be some things that you've learned well from your mom and dad, and there may be some things that you learned poorly from your mom and dad, from that observational reality. But the reality is that you have to create and work at creating something new with the woman that you're now married to. That you can't lead the home totally based on my mom and dad did it this way, therefore we're doing it that way. That you can come in with that mentality and be thinking that the way we're going to do things is the way my mom and dad did them. And you are not married to your mom and dad. You're the child of your mom and dad. You're the product of your mom and dad. So what you have to do is go and create with this new individual who you were originally designed to what? Rule together with. So you got to remember what you were originally designed to do. You were designed to rule together with them. And so if you're designed to rule together with them, you're now trying to figure out how do we rule together. So it's not, it shouldn't be a clashing, but what we do know is based on sin, what we talked about 2 weeks ago, is that now the woman is going to have a desire for her husband, but he's going to rule over her. And so what we're going to have to actually deal with is deal with the reality of what are we doing inside of marriage to where we're creating a new environment and we're constructing a new environment to where we are designing what God wanted to please him in our current marriage. So here's the deal. There has to be a separation from the old, and there has to be a creation and a connection with the new. So as it relates to husbands and wives, and he talks about the husband leaving his father and mother, but absolutely the wife also has to leave her father and mother. So women, now as you leave your parents, you now have to begin to come together with your husband, your wife, and figure out what's best for us. Now, this involves conversation. This involves agreement. This involves coming together to build a platform together as husband and wife, saying this is what works for us. Now, part of that might have come from mom and dad. This agreed upon in the new family, but it's got to be agreed upon. So let me give you some examples. A couple weeks ago, I talked to you about how in my family, what I saw as an observational reality was that my mom and dad did not argue in front of us. What they did is they got in the car or they talk in the bed at night when we were asleep about what went on. But I never saw my mom and dad argue in front of us. That's not the way they operated. They did that with their goal in mind being this, is that we always want Blake and Brian to feel like home is a safe place. We don't want them to feel like home is an off-base place. That was what they agreed upon, all right? But now I, as I told you, before I married Renique, I'm dating Kim in college, and Kim starts arguing with me, and I'm like, hey, hold up. Because I don't know how to argue with a woman, because I never saw how to argue with a woman. Now, I know how to argue with a dude, amen? And I know how to put some hands on a dude, but you can't do that with a woman. They'll send you to jail, amen? So I got to figure this out. So just because my mom and dad didn't argue, now I bring that into the marriage and that's not working. So I got to figure out how do Renique and I have successful arguments together, because it wasn't that my mom and dad didn't have arguments, we just didn't see them. Did you catch that? And so now Renique came from a single parent home raised by her mom. And so, you know, it was just like, hey, let's figure out what's going on. So just because I came from a so-called good thing in the past doesn't mean that that's good for me and Renique. Because now the reality is what I'll do is I will fear confrontation because I'm not used to it. And so as a husband, if I fear confrontation because I'm not used to it, I will become passive in my leadership style. So just because there's some good things that you saw at your home, you can't automatically make those so-called good things the right things for your marriage, unless agreed upon. Are you following me? So what I want you to really begin to think through now in your own mind as we're framing up this Bible study is how do I look at what I saw marriage in my family directly or in aunts and uncles or whoever, grandparents that I saw that began to give me the framework for marriage? And how have my husband and I, or the person that I'm looking at getting married to, how are we building our own program? Because he says, you are to leave father and mother, cleave to your wife, and you two become one. Catch that in your Bible. Then watch this, Genesis 2, verse 24. He says, and for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. Now, while that is a sexual union, it's also a marriage mentality where there is a unification, where you think on a one level. Now, it says the two shall become what? One. Watch this. Watch this. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one. Now, although there's God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, they're totally unified. Three different people, same goal, three different personalities in terms of what they actually do and function in the body of the Godhead, however unified in everything that they do. So when he says the two shall become one, it's not just some sexual union. It's a mental, emotional, spiritual, in every type of way where this husband and wife become one the same way God becomes one. So the ultimate goal in the two becoming one flesh is that the couple become God-like. Amen? Not just sex-like. That we have a thought process that we have agreed upon. That takes work. That takes heavy discussion. That's why I said quit going to the movies. You can't go to no movies and learn anybody on a date. All right? Now, let's walk to verse 25. Verse 25, he says this. And the man and his wife were both naked, and they were not ashamed. God designed our marital unions to create and cultivate an environment of exposure and acceptance and understanding. Now notice what he says, that they were both naked and unashamed. This is the original intent of God, is that Adam is coming to the relationship bare, naked, and exposed, and he's not ashamed. Eve is coming to the relationship bare, naked, and exposed, and she's unashamed. This word unashamed ultimately deals with, in the Hebrew language, of that although they were bare naked, meaning that they were physically naked, that they projected no evil intentions into what they saw. You see, this is not Instagram, where you see something and you project a little evil into that. Oh, y'all not on Instagram. Okay, my fault. I understand. Where you see an exercise video and you want, hey. See, now what we do is we see certain things that are exposed, or we wish they would be a little bit more exposed so that we could see a little better, and we have a projection into it. So when the Bible says that Adam and Eve were naked and unashamed, it means that they were literally bare and thought nothing evil about seeing the other person just like that. Now, this is deep, because the next thing you're going to see in just a few minutes is that you're going to see Noah get naked. And when Noah gets naked, you're going to see his son project something evil into what he saw with his dad being naked. And he comes out and he talks about his dad being naked to his brothers, but his brothers go back in and they cover dad up. So the original state of us being naked was that God was trying to show us, I don't want you to have anything in your private life that's in your private life. I don't want you to have stuff in your private life that you keep in the closet unexposed to the other person so that you can kind of hide inside a marriage. God never designed you to be married to a person and you hide away stuff in the closet that you keep over here that they don't know about. That we ought to be in this relationship that we've decided to come in union together. And if I'm able to be naked with anybody and unashamed, I ought to be able to be naked and unashamed with my wife. And I'm talking about in every area of my life. Watch this. If I was molested as a little boy growing up,
If I don't tell anybody, I'd be able to tell my wife that as a little boy, my uncle molested me. And I ought to be able to take the depth of that thing that I might be ashamed of that happened to me and share it with my wife. And with my wife, I ought to be able to be naked and unashamed. And she shouldn't take the data of my molestation and use it against me. Are you beginning to see what it really means to get in the naked and unashamed? So watch this. What if as a young lady, I was raped, and now the sexual problems I'm having in my marital union is that my very first exposure to marriage was, to sex was that I was physically or sexually aggressively moved upon. All right. So now I'm with you. And although I'm with you and that's a new thing and I do love you, my mind and my mental recorder replays this. Watch. So now here's the deal. When I got raped, my uncle, I was at my uncle's house and I was just sitting there at the table and he came behind me and put his hand on me like this and everybody else was gone and he put his hand on my shoulder right there. And so now that's how, you know, my uncle started to rape me. So now you're in the house with your wife and you come up to her during breakfast and put your hand on the shoulder right there and something clicks for her. Now, it's your wife now, but can she tell you what happened to her and you be able to deal with it? Hello, somebody? See, when you're really talking about being naked and unashamed, you're talking about, can I take the worst stuff of my life and share the very worst of my life with you and be safe? Hello? So when we start talking about what does it really mean to create an environment and cultivate an environment of exposure and acceptance and understanding, is that most people are married, but they're not naked and unashamed. We're holding stuff back. We're keeping things back. And so we're not able to have the depth conversations to increase our love and compassion for the person that we're dealing with. Hello? Am I talking to anybody? Okay, so I want to just talk about, we're not going to play with this tonight. We're getting ready to get into this thing, all right? So watch this. So he says that the two were both naked and they were not ashamed. Now watch this. Knowing our past lives, in our past lives, we have things that we're ashamed of, all right? Before we got married, let's just say to Jesus, I'm going to go there in Romans 6. Before we got married to Jesus, we have some things that we're ashamed of now that we're a growing Christian, that we wish we would have never engaged in that foolishness. I can't believe I wasted my life on some stuff like that. When I look at where I am now, and I really thought I was having fun, and now I realize I was just being used up, amen, and tossed away. So we have some things in our past lives that we're ashamed of. How do we enter and unite and achieve a naked and unashamed environment? All right? Now watch this. Walk with me to Romans chapter 6 real quick. Romans chapter 6. Romans 6, verse 20. Apostle Paul writes these words. For when you were slaves of sin, prior to being saved. And so what happens is that you and I enter into a marriage union with Jesus Christ when we get saved, right? So he says, when you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. God didn't expect you to live right. That's all he's saying. I didn't expect you to do no better. God had no expectations of the non-believer before they became a believer to do anything good. See, God is so honest with you. He says, you wasn't saved. I didn't expect nothing from you. So now you have a God who knows all you're bringing to the table is your worst. Y'all not feeling me just yet. You got a God who knows all you bring to the table is your slop and your filth. I don't care if you got one sin or 1 million sins. All you brought to the table was filthy rags. And I married you anyway. And I had no expectations of your past to be any good. This God marrying us. He says, watch him now. He says, for when you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. Therefore, what benefit were you then deriving? Watch this. What benefit were you then deriving from the things which you are now ashamed? You see that word? Y'all, I got the mic right now. I remember some college fraternity parties to where I felt like I was the life of the party. And I remember waking up in the dorm room on the floor close to the toilet. And I remember needing to throw up, but couldn't throw up, was dry heaving, and then finally got some out. And was just glad that some finally came out. I was just happy to get that throw up out as I could. But can I tell you something? My girlfriend left the room. So I said, Kim, why'd you leave me? She said, because you were acting a dang fool last night. You was at the party drunk and hollering and acting a fool. And I wasn't going to stay with you and do you were acting a dang fool. Now, think about this. President Association of Black Students, President Alpha Alpha, and I wake up next to the toilet. How are you proud of that now? See, the point simply being is there's some things in your past that you've done that you look back on and say, I woke up next to the toilet. Now y'all know don't everybody make it in the toilet all the time. Y'all ain't feeling me yet. See, y'all, and you lay it right there by the urine, you know. Right there. I need to be close to it because I can't get from the bed. I don't feel like I can get from the bed. So I just sleep right here. That was the decision I made. Things that you're now ashamed of. And here's the deal. With the shame of our past, can you bring the shame of your past to your new married mate and say, here's where I was. And if you can bring that to God, why can't you bring it to the person you're married to? If God will accept you with all of that, why can't you bring that here? See, because you don't really want to be deep with God, nor do you want to be deep with your mate. You want to act like you're halfway good. And yet God says, you weren't good at all, and I married you anyway. Watch this thing. So he comes down and he says, of things in which you are now ashamed, for the outcome of those things is death. Outcome of the things that you're now ashamed of was death. But now having been freed from sin and enslaved to God, you derive your benefit resulting in sanctification and the outcome, eternal life. In other words, God totally turned your life around. And your new benefit is although you were living a life that was leading to death, God came in and met you and married you and turned your total life around just like that. And watch this. When you come out of a life of past bad relationships and get married to this person, and that person is a representative of Jesus Christ, they ought to be the person leading you to life. Watch, in all the ways your past boyfriends devalued you, this man ought to value you. Y'all, I was preaching at a conference in Dallas, a Lifeway conference, and there was a conference called it's a mother's conference. And Priscilla Shire had my wife and I come and do the conversation on sex. And so we did this conversation. It was supposed to be an hour and 15 minutes. And it ended up being 3 hours and 15 minutes. You know, like they took the stuff out the room. They said, well, Mr. Wilson, you keep answering questions. But we're taking all the chairs out. We got to change the room. And literally, an hour and 15 minute session turned into 3 hours of women asking questions that they had never gotten to ask in their entire life. 73-year-old woman came up and asked me a question about some sex. I said, now, come on, ma'am. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you know, I'm cool with the 37 sister asking me, but you 73, big mama. Going on now. All right, now, but watch this. One of the questions that I got asked, no lie, lady came up to me and she said, Pastor, I feel ashamed having sex with my husband. And I said, well, why is that? And she said, because my husband was a virgin. And she says, and here's my sexual past. And she began to talk to me about all the men. She was of mixed background, black and white. And she said, and men just were attracted to me based on my outward appearance. And she said, so I literally have now de-emphasized my outward appearance. Doesn't, I mean, she's a nice looking lady, doesn't keep her hair up right or nothing. You know, it could be a lot better, but we're friends on Facebook now too. And here's the deal. She said, I had been with all these men because every man I knew appreciated me based on looks. And my dad wasn't really there after he and my mom and dad, after my mom and dad divorced. And I began to draw attention to men needing a male figure in my life. And all the men in my life just took me for physical love and I accepted it. But then I got saved in college and met a man who was saved in virgin. And I feel ashamed having sex with my husband now because I've got all this past and he was a virgin. I said, sister, you don't know how good God is. She said, what do you mean, Pastor Blake? I said, what God is showing you is this. God is actually showing you how much he believes in you and how much he values you. God allowed a virgin male to marry an unvirgin woman, a woman who had been around. And God is showing you, while those men didn't value you, here's how much I value you by giving you a virgin. See, but if you come to this thing ashamed versus understanding what God was doing, you'll be devaluing yourself and wondering all these negative things. And God has already covered that at the cross. Hello, somebody. So watch this. He said there's some things that we're ashamed of. So I want you to discuss at the table real quick. Knowing in our past lives some things that we're ashamed of, how do we enter and unite and achieve a naked and unashamed relationship? At your table for 5 to 10 minutes, I need you to discuss, how do we begin to enter into this new marriage, this new potential relationship, and enter in and unite and achieve a naked and unashamed environment? See, because if you're never planning to be naked and unashamed, you'll be in a marriage covered up just like you were with your boyfriend. And your husband has become nothing more than a long-term boyfriend. Amen. Y'all got 5, 10 minutes. Now, this section right here, this first question right here is very serious. And here's why. Because hopefully your answers that you're talking about at the table can actually give other people ideas and concepts on how to enter in and unite and achieve this thing. So you're not playing with this thing. You really want to try to say, man, how do we get this thing started to where we create a negative and unashamed environment and cultivate that environment? Amen. All right. Now, notice this. In this naked and unashamed environment, in this naked and unashamed marriage environment, your spouse, male or female, is going to see the best of you and the worst of you on a regular basis. On a regular basis. That's the person that's going to see the real you on a day-to-day basis, all right? So, anybody, your table, want to jump in and say something? Yes, ma'am.
We agreed that love covers the multitude of sins, and that the Bible says, you know, no self-condemnation. I would give the scriptures, but I have to go back to my phone right now.
Romans chapter 8, verse 1, 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8.
Okay. So, you know, all right. So what I was saying is the person that you love and they love you, that unconditional love, like the Bible says, mm-hmm. when you talk to them, they shouldn't go out and shame you except when they're talking to someone in Christ that's mentoring you all, not just telling the next church member how they feel about their mm-hmm. spouse. So that's something that we all agreed on.
Okay, good, good, good. No condemnation, and love covers a multitude of sins. Anybody else at the table? Mike, yep.
So two things came out of our conversation at the table. One was in this particular day and age, we don't have too many people that are just genuine mm-hmm. and just sincere. And willing to share. The other thing that came out of our discussion was having almost a disclaimer at the beginning of a conversation or at the beginning of a relationship saying, hey, look, you know, whatever your junk is, you'd murder 10 people and hidden the bodies. You know, literally, like, for real, whatever it is, go ahead and share it. And if need be, like, I'm here, I got you. Mm-hmm. And we'll figure whatever that thing is out.
Amen.
You know, whatever the recourse.
Amen. Anybody? Brothers, y'all better come back after that one. All right, go ahead.
As we were discussing it, we were saying, how does one actually start that conversation? Like, how do you approach it? And I was saying, from my background and from my husband's background, that's not the way we had, I guess, been raised. We had been raised in denominations where, oh, you have some feelings, you get married. But we haven't talked about how do we do finances? Mm-hmm. How do we unite? How do we be, you know, open in discussions and anything like that? It was just, you're supposed to get married. So, oh, okay, well, we want to have children. Let's get married. Now what do we do? How do you share stuff with me? And instead, what keeps happening is stuff pops up. I come to your homecoming. Who is she? And why is she staring at me? You know, those kind of things. Or the, point that... you know, I was taught, and some of the things he was taught, like, oh, you got some money on the side? Don't tell him you got no money on the side. You better get your little something on the side. Yeah. Save you something just in case he hacked up. You got your money on the side. Don't tell him you got that money. You know, so that's the way I was raised, so it's really hard.
And who else was raised like that? Who else was raised like that? No, for real. Put your hand up. Say it again how you were raised.
Grandma told me, look, you better have some money on the side. He don't need to know about that. Daddy... do you have some money on the side?
All right,
you got your little
now,
stash?
Brothers, how was y'all raised? Y'all better keep one on the side in case she act up. See, y'all keep money on the side. We keep another one on the side. That's what we was taught. That's what we was taught. We ready. Y'all take the money. We got another honey. Amen.
Yes, but how do you, just, we were saying, how do you start that conversation of we need to unite? We need to... just be open with each other. Let's share everything and get to unity.
Amen. You know, yes, sir. Go ahead. Jay, go ahead. Bring right here. He bringing it. So, listen, y'all. Listen. It's good stuff.
I didn't get a chance to say it at our table, but I believe and have learned that when men communicate their vulnerabilities, especially if you're married, it cultivates and creates a level of intimacy. I'm not talking about physical intimacy, but intimacy. And I think as men, when we step out on a limb and, you know, risk our stuff, so to speak, I think that sets up the foundation at some point for that woman to come to us and risk their stuff.
Amen. Stop right there. Amen. Now watch this, y'all. Write down Genesis chapter 12 and write down Genesis chapter 20. God puts a big, gigantic call on the life of Abraham. Abraham, you're getting ready to do something great. And the problem is Abraham got a good-looking wife. And so what happens is that Abraham is going into the area of Egypt, and he thinks that Pharaoh's going to kill him because he's got a good-looking wife. So what is Abraham's area of naked and unashamed that needs to be revealed? Fear. Fear. So Abraham has a fear and leadership and in trusting God. Abraham, listen to me very carefully. So all the stuff that we're dealing with is naked and unashamed is not just I got this sexual past. I have fear of leading and I have fear of trusting God, and I don't know where this road is going to take me if I put all my faith and trust in God, because as a man, I've been taught to work it out by myself. So the way I'll work it out by myself and leave God out is I'll say, hey, tell Pharaoh that you're my sister. And he doesn't just do it once, he does it twice. He does it in Genesis 12 and he does it in Genesis chapter 20. And his issue is his fear. And see, when can you as a man, what you just talked about, come and say, baby, this is what I see God doing in my life. And to be honest, will you pray for me? Because to be honest, to be straight up honest, I'm afraid. Will you pray for me? Because that's naked and unashamed. My leadership right now is shaky in my mind as a man. See, but we feel like that ain't manly. But that's that naked and unashamed where it says they were both naked and unashamed.
And that's where you cover me at that moment, and I'm going to cover you at a moment that you need it. Amen? And so you got to get deep. Yes, ma'am. Go ahead, Sister Slaughter. Go ahead. I'm going to stop. Go ahead. Yo, I'm sorry. Go ahead. Go, Derek. Go ahead.
For 99% of this table, we all said basically admit what you've done. Expose. Mm-hmm. Be upfront. Tell the spouse about what you've done in your past, or even if it's taken place while you're married. Because for as me, I didn't want her to find out what I had done. It's best that I go ahead and admit, because there were tapes and pictures floating around.
Amen. 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 Ain't nothing wrong with that.
Amen.
Look here, you better tell the truth with it.
Okay.
Where did we go? Yes, go ahead, go ahead, go ahead.
Well, Sister Phaedra just blessed us over here, because she was telling us that one of the most important things in a woman being naked and unashamed is that she trusts in her husband and she feels safe with him.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of times, if you feel like you're going to be judged or you feel like you're going to be looked down upon, you can't open up. You can't let go of things that you're ashamed of. So the first thing that is important for the woman is to feel safe and to feel loved in that marriage.
Now, brothers, let me just say this. It would be real wise, this is a hint to the brothers, for you to just, like, get your phone out, your iPad, or your pencil, and write that down.
Amen.
You want to repeat that one more time? Now, brother,
Sister Phaedra said, quote, quote.
Now, y'all, it's some women.
I got to give credit where credit is due.
It's some women nodding their head with me. So I'm trying to help you help you.
Amen.
Amen. Go ahead. Say it again. Okay. Say it again.
Sister Phaedra said that the most important thing is for the man to create a safe environment for the wife. She has to feel safe, like she won't be judged, she won't be criticized, and then she has that ability to open up.
Now watch this. For the man to create the environment. Now watch this. God creates an environment called confession of sin. And he says, when you confess your sin, I will forgive you.
That's right.
So here's the deal. When someone brings something to you, you get a chance, men, if the woman is sharing, to be the visible expression of Jesus Christ and let them receive Christ-like forgiveness. Hello, somebody?
That's good.
See, you got to realize that this thing is not just about your experience. It's about you reflecting Christ in the marriage. Because here's the deal. You got some stuff.
Amen.
Did God forgive it? And so, the problem is too many Christians think that they're walking two steps from Jesus. Too many Christians think, here's God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, and I'm right behind them. Now, baby, you better come on now, because I'm right here. Or either the wife thinks she's right here, she's super holy, and baby, you better come on, because I'm with the Lord. And what God is doing is creating environmental opportunities for a person to share, as Jason said, and as Sister Phaedra said, to where you can really create an environment to where things get deeper and deeper and create a deeper level of intimacy and trust inside that relationship, because that person was designed to handle your stuff. Listen to what I just said. It says they were both naked and unashamed. That's how God originally started it off. Now, let's go to this next slide. Let's go to this next slide. Are you willing to live naked and unashamed with your spouse, yes or no? That's just a straight up yes or no question. Now watch this. Here's the next part. How do you enter into discussions where one becomes naked and you cover them? Now let's go to 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8, because there's a group back there that was cheating. All right? Go to 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8. See, when you got good people in Bible study, they'll give the pastor's answers away too early. Go to 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8. Peter's writing and he says this. Above all, out of all the things I'm telling you, above all, keep fervent in your love for one another, because love covers a multitude of sins. You caught that? 1 Peter 4, 8. Above all, out of all your Christian ethic, keep fervent in your love for one another. Why? Because love covers a multitude of sins. Now, here's Jesus Christ. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. No greater love than a man has than this, than he laid down his life for his friends. The greatest example of love is what Christ did on the cross, where he covered our sins. And so when he says, now I'm talking to the body of Christ, keep fervent in your love for one another. Why? Because what love really does is love covers sin. Love doesn't expose sin, or love doesn't mess up and throw sin in people's face. Listen to me very carefully. Love, I'm going to repeat myself, does not take somebody's openness. When someone has shared something with you and then you throw it in their face in an argument 3 months later. You just broke the environment of naked and unashamed. I now see I can't trust you with that. I can't tell you that because now you're using it against me. All right? Now, I'm trying to help somebody get free tonight in terms of the reality of going deeper in your relationship with your spouse. And he says this, love covers sin. Now, the opposite is that you expose stuff and you talk about stuff and you don't realize that that's not how Jesus handles you. You have been entrusted in this marriage to cover that person in their worst moment. See, we got married because we thought she was cute. We didn't know she was going to have no mess. And God said, no. This marriage is just like Christ in the church. And Christ in the church is a dirty thing. Christ in the church is a bloody thing. So the way Christ in the church is not some cute union. Somebody got slaughtered in order to marry you. Someone was devastated and demolished to marry you. And the thing was, he took the beating and had done nothing. So when you start looking at this deal, how do you enter into discussions where one becomes naked and you cover them? You got to look at the reality that when someone opens up, listen to me, and shares something with you that right here, I'm exposing myself, I'm naked, and I believe because I'm married with you, I could share this with you, and I'm unashamed right now. And then you take that thing and use it, / misuse it. You're not creating an environment or cultivating an environment where a person can be naked and unashamed. Now watch this. Here's what happens. They go open up to somebody else because they need to talk to somebody. Hello, somebody? They'll go talk to somebody else on a deeper level. Now, here's the deal, y'all. I didn't come to play tonight. So I don't know where y'all are in this thing, but this is already heavy on me because we're trying to get set free. So I want you to see the reality of what we're trying to deal with. So now all you single folk, you think that this thing, baby, look here, I want to have sex and God not be mad. Like if your whole, I just want to have my little sex in peace and God ain't mad. And I have a good conscience. No. Baby, after that sex is over, he got some issues. And you got some too. And as my mom said, you can't have sex all day. You got to go to work, go do something. Amen. Now, somebody got to pay the light bill. You got to go. Now, watch this. Why is this important? Go with me to Genesis chapter 3, verse 21. Go with me to Genesis chapter 3, verse 21. Remember, love covers a multitude of sin. After Adam and Eve sinned, they tried to cover themselves, and then God covered them. Watch this, Genesis 3:21. He says, the Lord God made garments of skin for Adam and his wife, and he clothed them. The Lord God, Yahweh Elohim, Jesus Christ, pre-incarnate, not God the Father, not God the Holy Spirit, kills an animal, which is a picture of himself, that, watch this, the animals were created before man, the same way Jesus Christ was before man. So what he's doing is he's letting you know there's already a provision for your sin. That I had already prepared to cover you before you got naked. So he says this, God, real quick, what does he do? he covers them, the husband and the wife. Now, if God covers the husband and the wife, notice that the design was for them to be one. He doesn't cover the husband and then tell the husband to cover the wife. He doesn't cover the wife and then tell the wife to cover the husband. What he does is he covers them both. Why? Because y'all are one. Which begins to show you that if she's covered, I'm covered. If I'm covered, she's covered. God's ultimate goal is for no one inside the marriage to be uncovered. Is that God's goal is always the beginning example of you covering your mate. Amen? Now, so as we deal with this, how do you enter into discussions where one becomes naked and you cover them? I'm going to give you about 5 minutes to discuss this real quick. Because I want you to say, how do we begin to enter in to these discussions? Now, you're at your table tonight, but you're not at the table with your husband or your wife, or you're not at the table with your little boyfriend, your little girlfriend, whatever your situation might be. But you need to really start thinking through, how do you have some deeper discussions? Okay, now, y'all, marriage is going to get exposed every single day. I brought up some things earlier. I brought up molestation, rape, and things like that. That's going to come up in your marriage, that type of stuff. But you're going to also have persons that have been beat down by their family that you're married to, been talked down to in their family. Now, some kind of way, they made it out of all the verbal abuse and mental abuse of their own family, and now they're married to you. Or they saw a whole bunch of fighting in the house. And they know that yelling in my family environment, the next thing is somebody's in a fight. So now you get in your argument with your wife and you raise your voice, and she's not seeing you raise your voice. She's seeing dad raise his voice and slap mama upside the head. Are you following me? I'm trying to get you into a naked and unashamed environment to where people are coming with all kind of stuff. But most people are getting married in their 20s. Most people get married in their 20s if they're getting married early, on the early side of things, or if they get married in their 30s. So that means that they've been 30 years without you. You just came on cute 8 weeks ago. So you got 30 years to deal with to cover up so that y'all can start this new thing. All right, I'm going to ask this question to the ladies. Ladies. I want you at your table to come up with a possible area that you might share with your husband and you need them to cover. So I just want you to come up with a topic, like this happened, and I want to talk to you about this from my past, all right? So ladies, at your table, I want y'all to come up real quick with an issue that might have popped up, you know, and then y'all just toss that one issue out at your table, and then I want to see how us men would deal with it, okay? All right. Men, all righty. Ladies, give me one issue. One table, ladies, give me one issue. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Nathan, right here.
A topic we brought up was mothers overstepping their boundary in a relationship.
Mother-in-laws overstepping their boundaries. Y'all, this hard one right here, Doc. They came out. Doc, they hit a home run with that thing. That's out the park. All right. So here's the deal. Your wife brings up to you men. Your mama be tripping. Ladies, your wife brings up to you, your mama is tripping. How do you allow her to feel safe? And I'm talking about, I need a male table to answer this thing. How do you allow her to feel safe in her telling you that? And what is your position based on what she told you? Royce, give me an answer. Amen. Y'all bring the mic to Royce. I need y'all to get a good answer. Y'all better come on with something.
put on the spot.
What was the question? So how does she feel safe in asking the question?
Because she asked, she's told you your mama is tripping. How do you allow her to continue to bring that level of high sensitive data to you and feel safe, and then you also make sure she's covered? And what position do you take?
First and foremost, my wife has to know that she is number one. She has to know.
Write that down, brothers.
She's number one.
Write that down, brothers.
My wife has to know that although, you know, I may have been the only child, or I may have been the baby, or whatever the situation was at home, when I detached, or when I married her, or attached myself to her, she became number one. She's above mom, dad, sister, brother, all of that. And not only does she know it, all of them know it. They all know it too. They've been told, and the word is out to them that she's number one. So therefore, if she comes to me, that already sets the platform or the foundation for her to feel comfortable coming to me with an issue about my mom or my dad or my sister, my brother, my anybody. If she knows she's number one and she hears that often, and not only does she hear it, she feels it, it's actually carried out, then she knows she can come to me about anything.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. That's it. That's it. Hey, give it to Richard. Manifest Conference year number two. Manifest Conference year number two. One of our favorite speakers every year, Pastor Brian Carter, talked about the trouble between his wife and his mom at the men's conference, and the reality of having to deal with the struggle between his wife and his mom, and the real tear that it takes on the man. So ladies, even as you share with him, which is a true situation, realize he's torn as well. But although he's torn, he gotta be ripped the right way. And ripped the right way is towards the direction of your wife. And mama has to know, mama, this is my wife. Brothers, in that area, we gotta step up strong. My mom and dad, who have been married 58 years, if my mom were in here right now, she'd be running a lap all around this spot. And my dad would be sitting there laughing. Why? Because in my mom and dad's family, dad, there's no Trinity in Big Mama's book. Now, Big Mama's in heaven now, so she found out that there's only a Trinity. But Big Mama's book was there was a quadrinity. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, and James Robert, her baby son. And her baby son could do no wrong. And so here's the deal. When my dad graduated, went to teach at Smithville, dad was, you know, wasn't married yet, so he was kicking Big Mama a little money down, making sure mama always had a little something. You know, he was a single man. Then all of a sudden, dad and mom got married. Dad quit kicking the money down, and all of a sudden, Gene is a problem. Now, dad never told Big Mama, Big Mama, I'm cutting the money off. He just was smart enough to cut the money off. But he didn't say nothing on why he cutting the money off. And so now mama became the problem literally for the next 30 to 40 years. And so what literally goes down is Big Mama acts a fool one day. And y'all, we thought we was Dallas and the Ewings because we went out to Big Mama's house to eat every Sunday. You go out to the White House and you eat at Big Mama's house every day. And mom said, I ain't going out there no more. And so then we, as little kids, all we knew was, are we going to Big Mama's? You know, we be. And we knew that we were riding with dad, bye mom, you know. And mom was staying at home. But y'all, mom was making a very declarative thing. I want the whole family to know. I want Uncle Sam, Uncle EW. I want Uncle Bubba, Uncle Will and him. I want everybody in the family to know. I don't play that no more. And James, until you take a stand, I ain't ever going out to see your mama no more. Y'all, and they married 58 years, but she was serious about it. And they would tell you right now today that that was a deal that struggled in their marriage for over 30-some years. All right? And so we got to be, y'all, we got to be serious about this stuff. This stuff is not a joke. If your wife is unhappy over your mama, doc, you don't sleep with your mama. Amen? Good job, Royce. We're so proud of you. All right. Let's go to the next one. Go to Genesis chapter 3, verse 7. Go to Genesis chapter 3, verse 7. All right. Oh, Lord. All right. In Genesis 3, verse 7, it says, watch this. The eyes of both of them were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves loin coverings. Now watch this. What are some areas of our lives that we try to cover ourselves, yet it continues to cause problems in the marriage? See, Adam and Eve came up with their own solution to a problem that only God could cover. And Adam and Eve tried to cover something themselves that only God could come back and cover in Genesis 3:21. And God said, what you have tried to do in your own marriage to cover yourself is an insufficient covering. Therefore, I've got to give you a covering and send you out. But your efforts are insufficient. So here's the question. What are some areas of our lives that we try to cover ourselves, yet it continues to cause problems in the marriage? So let's holler some out. Let's holler some out. Finances. Very good. Now, here's one thing that I wanted to bring up. I'm glad y'all said finances. Glad y'all said finances. See, what if a man that you're marrying has no background from his parents on managing money? And here's something that my mom said, baby, we didn't have no money to tell you how to manage in the first place. See, the reality is, I was like, Mom, I'm in corporate America. They're talking about 401k and pre-tax and post-tax and all that. What were they talking about? Mom, why didn't you tell me about it? Blake, we ain't had no stocks. So there was no money to tell you how to manage in the first place. So now you have a man who's married you, he loves you, but he now has to become, in essence, the CEO of your home, and he has no financial background. How does he entrust you with the ability to manage the money and still be the man? Hello, somebody? Not just because he's the man doesn't mean he's the best financial manager or organizer or administrator inside the home. He don't know nothing about bill pay. He don't know nothing about automatic billing. So what that marriage might have to do is that marriage might have to say, hey, baby, I'm going to let you administrate because that's your gifting, and he's still managing the process, and you're responsible to, and you'll be able to tell him, hey, this is going to be paid on this date, this is done, this is it, and here are all the numbers. Baby, you need to know what the numbers are. Here are the account numbers. Here's how you're going to do it. But I'm going to make sure it gets paid. All right? So now you got to understand that there's some areas that men are coming to the table as well as wives are coming to the table, and we just don't have a background in it. And we got to learn that together, and I got to be naked and unashamed while I'm learning that. I can't have you looking down on me while I'm trying to learn something. Because you might have learned that already. You might have been taught that as a young woman. Or you might have been taught as a man, and she doesn't know that. All right? So there's certain things that we were trying to cover ourselves and manage our own way, and watch this, it's still causing problems in the marriage. Yes, sir, Mike.
Is it enough to just not look down on somebody? Because, isn't there a component where if you are the stronger in that particular area, shouldn't you actively work to build up your mate and make them more confident, considering the fact that they already are deficient in that area and they might feel some type of way about it? So you being the person that does have the background and does have the ability, but not necessarily the aesthetic position in the relationship, but you can go in and you can build that person up and build up that confidence.
Mm-hmm.
So, while you're still handling that business.
Amen. Let me say something to that, Mike. If there's never a sit-down conversation to where I recognize your strengths on the table and you recognize my strengths, if we never sit down and say, now, baby, look here, your boy, I don't know nothing about no money. Oh, don't worry about it, I got it. Okay, I'm glad you got it. See, and we realize that we're on the same team. See, but if we don't ever do that and we never establish your strengths and my weakness, watch this, because she was designed to be a helper, a suitable helper. So there's some strengths that God has given her, and you just can't come in, I'm the man. You just can't do that, all right? So you got to figure out in real conversations, what is she bringing to the table? What am I bringing to the table, all right? But that's too much work for folk. Folk ain't ever thought about that. What I'm trying to do is get you to think about some areas that you ain't ever thought about before. Because there's nothing wrong, Mike, with her having that gifting financially and bringing it to the relationship and building me up. But watch this. If we're in that last 2 weeks ago situation to where she's trying to take my position and I'm trying to rule over her, if we're in that natural marriage versus that supernatural marriage to where we're ruling together, see, when we rule together, that's what he said in Genesis chapter 1, is that I'm allowing her to rule the areas that she's strong, and I'm ruling the areas where I'm strong, but we're working together on the exact same team. But if I'm fighting for a position and not God's purpose, then I'm trying to be the man when there's some areas that God gave me her to bless me in. Renique is a natural administrator, so all our stuff going to be organized, not because of Blake. Everything will be organized. So I'd be like, go ahead, baby, organize that thing. Yeah, amen, I manage that thing, amen. Good decision. Good decision. Blake Wilson, CEO. So you have to know, Mike, I agree with you totally, and if you hear tonight what was said, is there areas that your mates, male or female, your husband, your wife, are going to be strong? Utilize it to your strength as a couple. As a unified unit, the two have become one flesh. Amen? So her strength becomes my strength. Amen? Because her strength was my weakness. My strength becomes her strength because my strength was her weakness, and we're on the same team. But if we're battling, we're messing that thing up. Yes, ma'am. Now she going to get the mic, and I'm coming to you. Come on, Nate.
What if the person is in denial about their weakness?
What if the person is in denial about their weaknesses?
Like just for finances, if you know he cannot handle the money well, and he has shown that plenty of times, but he say he got it. Mm-hmm. How do you deal with that one?
Well, I think to be totally honest, you have to look at number one, some major prayer. And I'm talking about those are them situations to where God has to break his pride factor. The reason why I said major prayer is because his pride is not allowing him to acknowledge this is not a strength area. And he wants it to be a strength area, but it's not yet. Because he's trying to prove to you or prove that he's the man when he doesn't have to prove that. He already is the man. And so it's got to be a major prayer area so that his pride factor can be brought down, and he has to understand who you are designed to be as the helper in the relationship to be a blessing to what it is. And sometimes you might have to just put a little sheet of paper up and say, now, babe, we done bounced these 72 checks under your management system. And look here, we could have gone on that vacation that you wanted to without paying for it, but we already caved the bank like $3,700 extra bill pay because you done bounced them checks. Amen? And now it's got to be done in the Holy Ghost way, lest he get mad. Amen? Let's go back to my sister. Go back. Y'all, this is some good stuff, but, we got to end at some point.
Thank you. What I wanted to say was, in all the conversations that can go forth, and if there's never a round table like Pastor, what you're saying, nothing ever happens. But even though there is a strength and a weakness, we're there for one another, so we always have to include them. That's where the problem is. It's because once they lend a hand to one to take care of it, male, the wife or the husband, if there's never an inclusion, when it's all said and done, I didn't know about that. Amen. So we have to do that because the word says, how can two walk together except they agree? But they have to agree in the word.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just in the conversation. It still has to be done decently and in order, but they have to be an inclusion.
Mm-hmm.
That's all I wanted to say.
You know, and that's why I'm saying, well, let me give you all a practical example of some friends who mentored my wife and I. Antoine and Dree, every Sunday night, listen to me very carefully. Y'all might think this is dumb, but they did it, and they've got a great marriage, and they mentored us. Every Sunday night, they would sit down in the room, and they had the table, and they would sit down. He'd put his hands out like this, and she would put her hands on top of his hands. And she would talk to him. She'd have a piece of paper here, and she'd talk to him about critical issues in the house that she had in home management off of her list. His hand was down like this with her hand on top to receive what she was saying. They did it as a sign of physical example, right? Then he had his little sheet, and she'd turn hers over, and then they'd do this, and he'd put his hand, and she would receive what he had to say. Then after that, they would pray about what they talked about. They did that every Sunday night. That was as serious as going to bed, and they kept the house in order. What I'm saying is you just can't go to bed tired and not put no work in. You know, to manage the home and to manage, you are in essence a CEO and a chief operating officer of your house. Renika will tell you I'm the COO of this house. He got the last say, and God gonna come to him. So I let him be the CEO. All right. So that's how we roll in the crib. She gonna operate some stuff. I'm gonna ultimately be responsible to God. But you have to sit down and have some real life discussions about what's going on. Some of you, the deal is, you could be out of debt if y'all sit down and have a conversation. You could quit getting killed financially if you sit down and have a conversation. And literally map out a plan and say, how do we go through this? But if you don't sit down and have any real meaningful conversations about the real stuff that's going on in life, you're going to lose for 30 years and wonder what in the world happened. You ain't never had no meeting. You never sat down and dialogue. You never sat down and put out an aggressive plan to do something. So there are things that we have to do to continue to progress